Picture in your head a rocket. What comes to mind? The legendary Saturn V, the notorious space shuttle, or the modern starship behemoth? Or what about a rocket so big that it needs to be launched from the middle of an ocean? What about a sea dragon? The Sea Dragon's creator was not some crazy engineer in his garage, but instead a very well-known engineer in his garage. Robert Trow was an American Navy veteran, serving on an aircraft carrier for 2 years before moving on to be an engineer with the military and immersing himself in the world of the early rocket. By the time the early space race had come, Robert was one of the best when it came to liquid rocket engines. However, Robert Trow soon realized the Saturn V wouldn't be enough if humanity wanted to explore and colonize the solar system, as it was being advertised all around the world back then. And so he headed a project with Aerojet to develop a rocket that would make us interplanetary by the 21st century. Today, unfortunately, that's not the case, but instead, let's take a look at what he and his team imagined. The Sea Dragon had two major design philosophies, ones that are only just starting to be employed today. One, simplicity to build the rockets, and two, reusability to fly them. First, we'll take a look at the design and take a deep dive into the way that Robert and his team planned to make the Sea Dragon into a reality. Part 1. Manufacturing. For the Sea Dragon, it wouldn't be feasible for it to be built by super specialized aerospace companies like the one that conceived the Saturn V. The scale of such an operation would just be too much. Instead, Robert, utilizing his Navy experience, devised a plan for the Dragon to be built like a boat, using boat materials, boat building techniques, and most importantly, boat infrastructure. Sea Dragon would be built in a shipyard, taking advantage of the massive welding capabilities that build battleships to build massive rockets. Because of this, however, the rocket needed to be simple. As I said beforehand, Robert Trow wanted minimal aerospace company interference, so he had to dumb down the rocket. The main way he did this was the engines. See, Robert had some great knowledge of engines and how to make the most complex and efficient ones possible, but he didn't want to do that. Instead, he settled for a design that contains just 4 valves and 2 tanks. The bipropellant pressure-fed rocket engine is one that, instead of utilizing generators, kickstarts, or batteries to feed its fuel, the engine simply puts denser stuff behind it and lets the basic laws of physics squeeze out the fuel until the pressure is equalized, kind of like blowing in a balloon until it's just about popped and then letting go. This kind of engine wasn't thought feasible by most rocket scientists at the time because it's rather inefficient, but Trow had a secret trick up his sleeve. Robert Trow scaled up the things until physics would allow the beast to run on the engine type. Now that you know it's getting built in shipyards, it shouldn't be a surprise knowing that the first stage has over 10 times the thrust of the Saturn V, and nearly 5 times the thrust of Starship. Before we jump into more of the rocket's mechanisms, however, we'll first take a look at the second design philosophy of the rocket, reusability. Even though the first stage was engineered to be as simple as possible, it would have been very expensive, and being able to recover it would bring the Sea Dragon to the next level. After detaching at an altitude of 25 miles in the air, maneuvering away from the second stage, the first stage would reveal a massive inflatable parachute, designed for the most drag-to-lift system ever created. However, that wasn't the only reusable part of the launch procedure. That's because recently we've seen SpaceX struggle to keep their launch infrastructure going, with the first launch of Starship creating a little crater in the air. Imagine that, but 5 times bigger. For reasons I will explain later, the Sea Dragon has no launch infrastructure, meaning no refurbishment, no replacement needed after every single launch. Part 2. Launching. Now we'll be taking our Dragon on the ground, putting its payload in space. Just have to figure out the in-between. As you've probably figured out now, we won't be having the launch on land. Instead, we're going to undertake a complex procedure to take the 500 by 100 foot vehicle and tow it out 35 miles to sea. Once it's there though, we're not done. The rocket's still lying flat down, and so using this handy little engine cover, we'll blow up a few tanks and submerge the Sea Dragon almost completely underwater. Right, we're ready. 3, 2, 1, ignition. First nothing, then a massive tidal wave screaming out the way of the rapidly accelerating Sea Dragon. The first engines to make it out of the waterline aren't behemoth, instead 4 smallish ones making sure the rocket stays upright. And then finally an explosion, one only parallel to the likes of atomic and hydrogen bombs, as the craft fully exits the water. Shockwaves will carry for tens of miles, probably even being heard from the coast. It's not long, however, till the first stage dies, 81 seconds to be exact. After dropping the first, another massive single-engine stage is unveiled with an iconic expanding nozzle that'll serve its job from atmosphere to interplanetary space. From then, the payload just has to survive SECO, second engine cutoff, and then it's free. Depending on where it's been dropped, this payload could be as big as the ISS. That's just mad. 10 years and 30 missions in one launch. Low Earth orbit wouldn't be its only frontier though. The Sea Dragon, if configured right, could transport 100 people to Mars and carry much more of that in terms of food, drinks, shelters, and experiments. Imagine the year 2000, where you have colonies on the moon and Mars, and orbital stations with thousands of people. Alright, we've got to admit, that's pretty neat. But unfortunately, it's also not what happened. Interest fell in space, the Americans won the race, and funding for the space program was cut. Today though, we're not relying on governments for our exploration of the final frontier. Private companies are starting to do that for us. And so even though the Sea Dragon's era never came, what will be the rocket to take us beyond our little cradle? Well, I've made a few comparisons of the Sea Dragon to Elon Musk's Starship, but in reality, they're almost totally different. Starship's goal isn't to be the biggest rocket humanly possible, its goal is to be a big rocket, but one that can fly tens of times a day. One of the most valuable metrics when measuring rocket success, as Elon Musk thinks at least, is how much it's going to get to orbit over time. For example, if the Sea Dragon launched 5 times a year, that's 2,500 tons of stuff that can be put in low Earth orbit. However, if one Starship launches every day, that means it can get 54,750 tons to orbit. Just truly insane. If you want to dive deeper into the modern space industry, check out my other videos. And in the meantime, become my 97th subscriber. Cheers.